Good morning, and thank you very much for joining us this morning. My name is Elfreda Jonker. I'm from Alphinity Investment Management. We are an active fund management business based here in Sydney. We manage global as well as Australian funds across core and sustainable strategies. So what we look at when we do investing is we look for high quality companies that's trading at reasonable valuations in an earnings upcycle. So those are the sort of companies that we refer to as earnings leaders. What we will be talking about today is just an example of four of those business models that we invest in our global funds currently. That's really withstood the test of time over the last 12 months, where investors have really had to experience all four seasons in just one year. So let's get into it. Before we get started, let's reflect on what's happened over the last 12 months. So as you can see in this slide, the blue line is the MSCI World Index. It really hasn't been a straight line since the COVID lows that the markets have started to rally. If you look at it, there's Europe in the green line, you've got US in the yellow line, emerging markets and Australia. So it really has been a very volatile time for investors. And it's no wonder, if you look at everything we had to cope through over the last 12 months. We had geopolitical wars, Russia, Ukraine. Then we had central banks really having to start to hike rates because of very high inflation levels. Then the recession fears came and they're still with us. And then of late, we also had a US banking crisis as well as the debt ceiling debate. All of those have caused a lot of volatility in global equity markets, so really making it quite difficult for investors to find those investments that can actually give you a good performance. To add to that, you haven't really seen any specific style do very well. Normally what you can see on this chart, the yellow line is global, the MSCI World Growth Index over value, and the blue line is cyclicals versus defensives. So normally what you would see is a longer period of one style outperforming the other. As you can see on this slide, from 2018 to 2020, that yellow line is growth outperforming. And then since the COVID lows, you actually had cyclicals outperforming, which is that blue line. But over the last 12 months, you haven't actually seen any specific style being in vogue. Can see those lines both go up and down. Of late, you've had growth outperforming, driven by the big rally that we've seen in the growth tech stocks. But really, this makes it very hard for investors that's only focused on any one specific style. So at Alphinity, we are core investors. What that means is we invest in any style company, as long as they are an earnings leader or in an earnings upgrade cycle and have great quality. To make things even more interesting for global equity investors or in investors overall has really been the narrow breadth of the rally that we've seen. So year to date, the S&P 500 is up 11%. Most of the global markets are up double digits. I know here in Australia, only up around 2%. But what we have seen in the US is that 11% rally has really only been driven by seven stocks. So this chart reflects those seven stocks. So they're the big names like Apple, Microsoft, Nvidia. And not really only because of uncertainty when investors flock to high quality companies with growth because growth is scarce, the underlying fundamentals of these companies have actually also improved. So for example, Microsoft and Nvidia has really benefited from artificial intelligence, and I'm sure you've heard a lot about that already today. And then companies like Meta, for example, or Facebook has announced big job cuts. So they're seeing earnings upgrades and it has been good. But if you haven't been invested in those seven stocks, it has been a relatively tough time. If you look at the rest of the market on a market cap weighted basis, it's been pretty flat. So that makes it challenging for investors. The other key thing to look at as investors is earnings. That's one of the major drivers of a share price. What we're reflecting on this chart, the blue line, that is the MSCI World Diffusion Index. Or really what it is an earnings sentiment index. It shows you the number of analysts upgrading versus downgrading expectations. So it really is a gauge of what will happen with earnings going forward. The other line, the green line, is the US ISM Manufacturing Index. So that's a gauge of proxy for what's happening in the global economy. And over time, you can see that there's quite a nice correlation between what analysts are expecting the global economy to do. Since the last COVID highs hit, earnings have actually been in a downgrade cycle. So that's really hard. If you don't get earnings, what will drive that share price performance? And of late, we have seen more analysts cutting expectations than upgrading expectations. So that's a really negative sentiment to be in. That line just over the last month have actually turned up positive again, but the ISM is still below that 50 or in that contractionary environment. So currently as we stand, it's very unclear if that line will continue to go up and we will see earnings upgrades come through again, or if that's actually going to push us further into a recession. So that's really why investors need to ensure that they are ready for whatever season we will be hitting next. The last factor I will reflect on before we go into stocks is really just the valuations. That's the other key driver of share prices. And as you can see on this chart, the green bars are effectively the 20-year range, valuation range of each of the major indices. That dark line is the 20-year average, and the diamond is the current valuation. So as you can see with the MSCI World all the way to the left, is that overall equity markets are actually trading in line with long-term averages. So the rally we've seen of late has pretty much been driven by multiple expansion. What that tells you is that equities are not actually super cheap at the moment. So when you invest, you also don't have that benefit of investing on a very cheap valuation, and you can see how that stock drives up. So all of these factors make it super important to do that bottom-up stock picking, because on an index level, the outlook is certainly very uncertain still. So what does this mean, and how do you put all of this together? So in an environment like what we've seen over the last 12 months, it's very volatile, lots of different challenges. What you really want to focus on are those businesses with killer business models. Today we will be reflecting on four of those. McDonald's, Intuitive Surgical, Mercado Libre, as well as Microsoft. These are all four earnings leaders. They're in earnings upgrade cycle, and they have fantastic business models that are very unique for their own reasons and very differentiated. So let's go into each of them, and I'll tell you why we've liked them and why they've actually done very well over the last 12 months, and we believe will have a place in the future as well. So first up, McDonald's. I'm pretty sure none of you really need an introduction to McDonald's. This is the largest restaurant chain in the world by sales. If you look at that right-hand chart there, it's truly global business. They've got 36,000 restaurants spanning over 120 countries. But there's a reason why McDonald's has been around for a long time and why they continue to do well and continue to see the earnings grow year after year. There's four main reasons that I'll flag. The first one is able to pass through price increases. As we all know, inflation has been high, food inflation in particular, but McDonald's has been able to manage that price increase, to push it through and not give up the volume. Secondly, they are really a very global business, as I've mentioned. They can continue to grow and continue to expand their footprint. Then they also have a very impressive execution of their strategic initiatives. So every year you hear about a new one. So they've incorporated drive-through, for example, and a whole digital offering, which is one of the two big growth areas for them currently. And then finally, they really are fantastic with their marketing campaigns. So for example, these are some of the campaigns that they've run of late. The pictures there are of Sohiti and Travis Scott. Well, my kids tell me they're American rappers, and apparently their burgers taste a lot better than anybody else's. If that's true or not, who knows? But the point is, they continue to be very creative with the way they present their products and continue to grow. This is a defensive business. So on an evening like last night, when the market sold off on fears of high interest rates, a business like this one did very well. The next up is Intuitive Surgical. This is a very interesting business. They're the pioneer in robotic-assisted, minimally invasive surgery. So what that all those big words mean is these are the really big machines that doctors use for operations to really ensure that they cause as minimum damage to a patient as possible. And the reason why this business model is so fantastic is that if you think about robotics in surgeries going forward, we really think this market can grow 5 to 10 times over the next 5 to 10 years. Not only is the amount of procedures that you can do with these fantastic machines growing, so initially it was only certain areas, like you only could do it for cancer. Now it's growing to urology, gynecology, gastro diseases, a number of ranges, and that keeps on expanding. So as you can see on this chart on the top left, that's a number of procedures growth for intuitives. Over the last few years, that's grown by 18%. And we expect that that growth rate can really continue as they expand not only the number of procedures that they can do, but also the number of countries and hospitals they can roll their products out to. So they really are the leader in this. And these machines cost quite a lot of money, around $1.5 million. But what they do is it's also an ecosystem model. So once you've bought their machine and it's in place in your hospital, they also offer services around it. So they offer training, additional parts, servicing. So as you can see on the bottom chart there, majority of the revenues are actually recurring revenues. So every month you keep on receiving it, making it a very defensive business model. So it's really integrated, and we think there are a lot of drivers. A company like this, even though it is a healthcare stock, is really a sort of a tech healthcare stock. So the valuation on this one is normally quite a bit higher than the rest of the sector. And you really need to manage your position size depending on what that valuation looks like as well. So really good earnings growth, expected to continue to come through in this company, and a long area that we believe a long runway for a company like this going forward as well. The next one I want to talk about is something very different, Mercado Libre. If you haven't heard of this company, it is the largest e-commerce and fintech company in LATAM. They currently have around 88 million active users across 18 countries. So think about a combination of an Amazon as well as a fintech company, as well as a credit company. This really is an ecosystem company. So what they do is they offer not only an e-commerce marketplace, but when you order, let's say you want to order your new Apple headset, you can order it through them, you can borrow money from them. They've got a logistics business that will drop it off for you or deliver it to your house. And so the circle goes on. So it really is a fantastically managed business. I think the nice thing that Mercado Libre also offers a global portfolio is that it's an emerging markets business. It's in LATAM, and it really gives you an exposure to some of these economies, like Brazil, for example, which is their biggest market. That's really well ahead of where we are at in some of the developed worlds, in the sense that they've already passed the interest rate hiking cycle. They already see inflation coming down, and you really can already start to see growth bottoming and expected to improve from that perspective as well. So it does give you not only a nice ecosystem stock to invest in with fantastic growth, also around 55% earnings growth expected on a compound basis over the next 3 years, but it also gives you that additional exposure and diversification into a different market. The last one I'll mention is Microsoft, and I sort of feel like you can't speak about global equities at the moment without talking about something around artificial intelligence. Now, this is definitely a stock not just because of that, but it's got multiple facets. That's fantastic. Microsoft has got two main growth drivers at the moment, and the reason why we still like it. Firstly, we have it's got a big cloud business through Azure. So globally, there are currently around three really big cloud businesses. So you've got Amazon AWS, and you've got Google Cloud, and then you've got Microsoft Azure. Cloud is one of those areas that just continues to grow. Think back around COVID times when all of us wanted to work at home, had to work at home, and wanted to upload all our work to the cloud. So that continues to grow. On the other hand, they've got artificial intelligence, which is really, I think, not just through their relationship and investment in OpenAI or the creator of ChatGPT, but also the ability to roll out artificial intelligence across their product suite. So for example, if you think about Teams, most of us use Teams when we do meetings. What they're rolling out now is Teams Premium. So currently, if you subscribe to Microsoft 365, it's costing you around $150 a year for all the applications. Teams Premium will cost you currently around $120 a year. So that shows you that's just one area where they're already increasing what they can charge you. So for example, Teams Premium, what it does, if you have your Teams meeting, it does the meeting notes for you, summarizes it, gives you action points, can pull up charts of things that's been said, pick up things that you said you need to look into. So it's really going to revolutionize what we can do. And that's just one part of Microsoft. And we all know how many areas they do have. So there's a massive revenue potential uplift for every extra $50 that they can charge a user currently of the 500 million users that they have. They can add around 12.5% to their current revenue. So it really is phenomenal. We're only at the beginning of that stage. So really for us, Microsoft has got a number of different facets. It's currently trading on around a 24 times PE, so it's not trading on a very extensive PE, and we still see scope for further growth and further multiple expansion in this one. So let's start all together. So there are many wonderful business models, but the important thing for us at Alphinity in particular is that we want to offer our investors a diversified yet concentrated portfolio. So a concentrated portfolio of around 30 stocks that's really high conviction, high quality, and are earnings leaders. But we also want to be diversified. We don't just want to be exposed to one sector or one theme at any point in time. So what this chart shows you on the left is our sector exposure. And on the right, we have our geographical exposure. So what we want to see here is we want to see many slices of that pie. On the left, you can see that we currently have a lot of exposure to consumer disk, information technology, but also industrials, financials, healthcare, and so forth. As well as from a regional perspective, we want to be able to have exposure to a number of different countries and economies, and not just one. Finally, this is just a reflection of the current top 10 of our global equity fund. We won't go into each one of these names in a lot of detail, but really what we want to show here is that the top 10 is very concentrated. There's around 43%. Normally it's 40 to 50% of our portfolio would be in the top 10, but it's a very diverse set of stocks. There are six different sectors represented here. And every single one of these companies have very different drivers and very different business models that we believe can deliver better than expected earnings growth, and they're very high quality companies. So to bring it all together, Alphinity has recently listed our two global stocks on the ASX as listed ETFs, so Alphinity Global Equity Fund, XALG, and Alphinity Global Sustainable Fund, XASG. So if you would like more information from us, please visit our website, alphinity.com.au, or contact one of our Fidante BDMs if you've got a representative to help you. So thank you very much. I'll now open it up to some questions.